invite up Dr. Justin Annis, who is an endocrinologist at Stanford and a laboratory researcher and has a special interest in inherited syndromes in neuroendocrine tumors and cancer genetics. So a question that came up earlier is, how do I know if I might pass this on to my children, or how do I know if this is inherited and part of my family? Justin's going to talk about that, so thank you.
Great. Sorry, I just want to be able to make sure I can see the slides. Thank you, Pam, and thank you all. It's really great to have the opportunity to be here and to meet with patients because so much of our time is spent in the laboratory working on something, and this is sort of a inspirational, at least for me, to have this opportunity. I know it's both important for you guys, and it's also very important to us, so thank you for letting me be here. So I was going to talk a little bit differently than Dr. Fisher, who focused more on somatic mutations, and now we're going to look more at what can be passed along. So what are the mutations that could be in every cell of your body, and therefore, is it not, you're not able to hear it? Okay. It's the angle. It's just sort of hard to... So to keep you all interested, I thought the best way to frame the talk was to ask the question, is it possible that I have a neuroendocrine tumor syndrome? And I'll try to stay out of the nuances of each of the individual conditions so there's no disclosures. So the first question is, why do you perform, or why are we interested in assessing for hereditary condition? And the reasons are because it can give you specific prognostic information about your tumor. For instance, a paraganglioma that occurs in the setting of a succinate dehydrogenase D mutation is different from one that occurs in a SDHB mutation. So we look at them and think about them differently. It also lets us think about what other potential disease risks you might have. And then, of course, we can use that to evaluate family members to try to catch tumors before they have the opportunity to progress. And importantly, I'm going to talk about conditions that are currently are recognized and testing for them is recommended across multiple societies, not really talking about experimental genes, such as IPMK, which is still, you know, in this question box. And then you should realize that genetic testing in general, we believe, offers patients a benefit. But it's not proven in every case that knowing the mutation that's in your family will definitely improve outcome. But we think in most cases it will. And then, of course, it remains unproven what the best management strategy is in a lot of these conditions. So these are the caveats. So I think probably the most common question in the room is whether or not may have asked yourself is whether or not you have MEN1. And then, of course, the related question is, well, what is MEN1? So it's an autosomal dominant inherited tumor predisposition condition. That means it passes from one generation to the next with 50-50 risk that someone in the next generation will be affected. And I don't have a pointer here to highlight aspects, so do your best to follow along. What are the features of MEN1? So the most prominent feature is a parathyroid adenoma, and that occurs in almost 95 to 98% of individuals with MEN1. The second prominent feature are the GEP tumors, so gastroenteropancreatic tumors, which include insulinomas, can include gastrinomas, and that occurs roughly 70% of MEN1 patients. And then pituitary tumors are the other big group. So these are sort of the big three of MEN1. And then there's a whole bunch of other associated tumors, which include things like carcinoid, and then pheochromocytoma is not up here, but rarely pheochromocytoma. Okay, so then this is the big question. When you have a tumor, you have to decide whether or not it's likely or unlikely that you have MEN1. And so this slide, which is complicated, is what I wanted to focus in on. So on the left, you have the sporadic cases, okay? So these are people with no evidence in their family that there's neuroendocrine tumor syndrome. And so at the top are patients or individuals who have three neuroendocrine tumors that exist, that means pituitary, parathyroid, and a neuroendocrine tumor of the GI tract. And then they get genetic tested for MEN1. Even in the situation where you have all three of those tumors but no family history, there's only a 70% likelihood that you will have an identifiable mutation. And then this is going to drop every time you lose a specific tumor. So if you only have two of the condition, it goes down to about 25%. And then if you have one tumor type, so either parathyroid tumor or pituitary tumor or even a pancreatic neuroendocrine tumor, if there's no family history, generally there's an extremely low possibility. Here in this particular study, it was zero, but it's extremely low likelihood that you have MEN1. And that's useful for reassuring in people and talking about what the risks are to children. Now, the situation changes once you have a family history. So family history here is very loosely defined. It means that someone, a first-degree relative, a father, a brother, a sister, or a child, has one of the big three tumors, either pituitary, parathyroid, or a GI neuroendocrine tumor. And so in that case, if you had all three of those and a family history, then about 90% of individuals will have an MEN1 mutation. And then what we'll talk about in the next slide is what happened with those other 10%. Then next, if you have two, the rate's dropped about 60%. And then finally, when you get down to one, it's around 30%. Okay, so there are these individuals that have no family history, or they have multiple family members affected, and yet their MEN1 test was negative. What do we do then? So this goes back to a little bit about when you were tested. So previous technology really only relied upon sequencing, just reading the DNA. But we've learned that there can be deletion mutations. So large chunks of DNA can be missing in the MEN1 gene that wouldn't have been picked up previously. So if you were tested a long time ago and it was negative and you still think you might have it, going back and doing deletion analysis makes sense. Also, there have been other genes identified that have MEN1-like phenotype. And I've listed those there. So regardless of whether or not you have an MEN1 mutation that's identified, if there's a strong family history, the recommendations are going to be to behave as though you do have an MEN1 mutation, and children should be considered at risk and they should be screened accordingly. And then something that's come up more and more recently is, well, what happens if my tumor gets tested and I find an MEN1 mutation there? Is it likely that I have a hereditary form of MEN1? And in fact, that's not the case. MEN1 mutations are very common in somatic mutations, but that doesn't reflect that they're in your germline. That means you're going to pass it on from one generation to the next. And then I'm going to skip over the standard MEN1 screening for now. We're short on time, but if you have MEN1, you hopefully are plugged in and children have been screened and are being followed appropriately. Okay, and then there are a few, so particularly for pancreatic neuroendocrine tumors, in isolation, once they're seen, you should think more broadly, could this be part of another syndrome? Are there any other considerations that my physicians should have? So VHL is at the top of the list. That usually is an association with renal cell carcinoma or pheo, but not necessarily, so it should be thought about. Neurofibromatosis, this is another condition which is usually associated with bumps or lumps on the skin or those brown growths in your eye, the Lish nodules. One of the really common findings are those cafe au lait spots or brown spots or freckles under the in the axilla. So rarely do we develop freckles in that particular location, but people with NF tend to. And then tuberous sclerosis is much less common, although in women they can have a very mild phenotype. So I won't go into it again for time because we're talking about a little bit esoteric here with tuberous sclerosis. And then the next consideration for the room would be medullary thyroid cancer. And then here we really focus on MEN2 or the RET gene. So the RET gene can come in three varieties or mutations, just familial medullary thyroid cancer, so that's the only feature that people in the family get, or it can be associated with pheo and parathyroid adenomas. Or then finally, you can have also physical features as well, depending upon the specific mutation. So the bottom line with MEN is that anyone who has medullary thyroid cancer should have RET testing. And that's because approximately 10% of individuals, even in the absence of family history, will have a RET gene mutation. The importance of identifying your mutation in MEN2 or in RET is because it allows us to give specific and targeted care. When should I have my thyroid taken out? That can be guided by the mutation, the specific mutation. And then lastly are the pheo and paraganglioma syndromes. The paragangliomas, the nomenclature around this is sort of complicated. Both paragangliomas and pheochromocytomas are neuroendocrine-derived tumors. Pheos, for whatever reason, got separated out early as being something different because they happen to be located in the adrenal medulla, but embryologically, they're essentially the same thing. So it's best to think of paraganglioma and pheochromocytomas as basically the same entity. And things have changed in the para-pheo world. In 2002, there was a really big change in the way we think about it. In medical school, people were typically told that about 10% of pheos are hereditary, and that they occur in the presence of these syndromes of NF, MEN2, and VHL, which I discussed. But in 2002, a study was done where they took individuals who had a paraganglioma, a functional paraganglioma, that means it was making norepinephrine, and these individuals had no family history of a para or pheo, and they performed genetic testing on them and said, what's the likelihood that we find actually a hereditary mutation? And it's upwards of 25%. So with the absence of a family history, if you have a para or a pheo, there's still at least a 25% chance that there's a genetic basis for it. So that leads to an obvious recommendation, which is if you have a para or pheo, genetic testing is indicated. Here I've talked about most of them. What I wanted to just hone in on were the SDH mutations, which I haven't touched upon. SDH B, C, and D are associated with specific tumors, so gastrointestinal stromal tumors and renal cell carcinoma. So if you have these associations, it should lead you towards thinking about these as potential causes. I'm going to skip this for the purposes of time. I know you guys are getting towards the end of your day. But suffice it to say that we have specific guidelines for screening individuals once they have a recognized tumor. Okay, and then I think this is the really important slide, in a sense, is trying to justify genetic screening. How do we know we're doing the right thing for patients by identifying their genes and telling them they should get all this testing done, even if they don't have any symptoms? So here, first, we're looking at what's the impact of doing biochemical testing, looking for elevated metanephrines in patients who have a hereditary pheo syndrome. And what we found was, if you look at the time patients present with a pheochromocytoma, if they just came to clinical attention because they developed symptoms, obviously they're going to be more likely to have symptoms than if you do screening and look for the tumor. So what the numbers show, which is sort of highlighted in yellow, is that if you screen, tumors are identified before symptoms, or more frequently before symptoms develop. But more importantly, if you initiate screening, then you identify tumors at a smaller size. So in this case, it was 7.3 centimeters versus 3.7 centimeters. And that's important. Being below the cutoff of 4 centimeters, we generally think of as being something that's noteworthy. So we think we can identify tumors earlier if we know to look for them. Sort of obvious, but it's important to demonstrate. And then I think the second question is, well, how do we use imaging, and is that useful? And so this is a study that's directly comparing patients who undergo imaging and biochemical screening simultaneously. And in this case, they're looking at MRIs. So if you get MRIs done, the likelihood of finding a tumor that's there is about 87%. That's the sensitivity. Occasionally, tumors will be missed by imaging, but if you're doing MRIs, you're likely to find them. Those same patients who underwent biochemical testing, only about 37% of them were positive. So if you're just doing the biochemical screening, you're missing a large portion of the tumors that could be found by MRI. Now, here we don't know if finding it earlier is necessarily a good thing. You know, would the biochemical testing turn positive? That's possible, but there are many biochemically inactive tumors. So again, for SDH mutations, in particular SDHB, imaging is strongly recommended. There's always shifting ideas about how likely it is for someone with a particular mutation to develop a tumor, and those ideas and our concepts change over time. So initially, for succinate dehydrogenase mutations, for instance, we thought everyone with the mutation develops a tumor, and that's because we found mutations in people with tumors. But as you started to screen all the family members, over time what we found is that, well, actually it's only about a third of patients will develop a tumor sometime in their life if they have an SDH mutation. So this is called decreased penetrance, and this is partially responsible for patients presenting without any family history, because not everyone with a mutation will develop a tumor. The other important aspect of the slide is the lower graph. This is saying when was the first tumor identified in affected patients, and people don't develop them all the way out into their 60s and still have a hereditary basis. So just because you were older when you had the tumor doesn't mean it can't be genetic. Okay, and then this is the last slide, and it's complicated, but I bring it up because there's been a notable change. So this is specific for the SDHD individuals. SDHD is inherited in an unusual way. It's called autosomal dominant but imprinted, and in particular, it's imprinted by the mother's lineage, so you only express or make the broken gene if you get it from your father. So if we look to number 7 or the black square, that's a dad who is affected, and you can see that about half of his children are affected. If you look over on the right, or on the other side where the number 1 is, that's a woman who in later generations will have affected children, but she herself is fine. Then she passes it along to her son in 3-1. He's fine, but then he has a son who is affected. So as long as it's passed through the maternal lineage, you don't have developed tumors, or at least that's what we've told patients until now. But recently, as we start looking in more and more pedigrees, we're finding that actually patients who have received the gene from the mother are on occasion developing tumors. So the important point here is if you're an SDHD family and you were told that, oh, I don't have to worry, I got it from my mother, our recommendation has changed just as of this year. So you should have screening done. Okay, so let me just summarize some of the main points I made. You guys are in the home stretch here. So isolated carcinoid and pancreatic neuroendocrine tumors are not usually part of an inherited condition, but if you develop one, this should trigger consideration of a genetic condition. So it's unlikely you do, but it's very easy to do the appropriate clinical evaluation to exclude that possibility prior to going forward with and performing genetic testing. So it should be considered. Other important points is that if you've had MEN1 negative testing, but there's a strong family history, we now have other genes that are worth considering. All medullary thyroid cancers should have RET testing. All paras and pheos should have genetic testing. And then the last thing is that genetic testing is useful because it informs how your condition is managed and how family members. This is a last slide, and we heard a lot just a little while ago. I didn't know that there was going to be this discussion about modeling in mice. So a lot of what my lab has been trying to do over the past 4 years is model hereditary pheo. In particular, it's been hard to model the more aggressive form of it. And so here I grabbed a couple slides because we've just recently have had some really good success in doing this. So the one that sort of has that big hole in the middle, that's a vein that's sort of in the middle of the adrenal medulla where the M is, that's a normal mouse. And then the one that says pheochromocytoma over it, that's sort of more standard what people have been able to model in the mouse, where you can see the whole medulla is large and filled, but it's less invasive. And then I think recently we've been able to develop a mouse model that actually develops invasive pheo, and we think this is, for the first time, a model that's really useful for understanding this more aggressive form of hereditary pheo and paraganglioma syndrome. So it's still early, and this is just sort of exciting results for us, but it was a breakthrough that I wanted to share with you guys. And that's it. Thank you.